All right. We're normally... Oh, okay. All right. Normally, this is where we give announcements, but I'm going to throw a curveball at you, and I'm just going to start preaching right now. All right? We're going to dive into God's Word, and make sure you stick around at the end of the service. After I preach, we will still have announcements. Greg, you will have your time. Trust me, okay? We will still have announcements, and we'll get to worship the Lord through the giving of our tithes and our offerings at the end of the service. But it is officially Christmas season, and I count it a great joy and a great honor to get to share with you today this beautiful passage that is Luke chapter 2. I'm going to share with you this passage, Luke chapter 2, and this series that we're going to be in is a two-week series. The first message is today, and next week, Pastor Dave Stone's going to close it off with week two of this series. The series is called Unto You, Unto You. And straight out of Luke chapter 2, and the message I want to share with you today is called Good News of Great Joy. Good News of Great Joy. Well, it's no secret in the Hoagland family that I love Christmas. I love real Christmas, where we do this and we remember what Jesus did, and we rejoice in what he did. That's real Christmas, but I love all of it. I love that it's getting colder. I love that it's maybe could snow. I'm still like a kid every time it snows, just so you know. Every time it snows, I'm super excited. I love the traditions. I love the music. I love all of it. I mean, if you guys knew when I started listening to Christmas music this year, it would probably be a little offensive to you. Because, yes, I start pretty early in the month of November because I love it. I love all these traditions. And somehow around Christmas time, we revive our love for orchestral jazz music. You know what I mean? Like all these Christmas songs that we listen to. I mean, all that disappears come January. Like, no one's listening to Bing Crosby in January, right? I mean, and if you are, I'm glad you're here. You need a little bit of help, and I'm going to try to help you. I mean, what kind of a name is Bing anyways, right? Like, this is my friend Bing. I don't know anyone who's named Bing. But by the time we get to January, it's all gone. And I love Christmas. I love all the traditions. I want to share with you a story from our family. And it has to do with my son, Raphael. So if you haven't gotten the chance to see him, everyone calls him my little clone. So here's what Raphael looks like today. That is Rafa, and he is a sweet, sweet boy. He's got tons of energy, and he also has a very tender heart, and I love being his dad. But before Rafa looked like this, he looked like this. So there he is at 1 year old, and this is November 2015 when I took that picture. And so Rafa's a one-year-old little boy, and we are getting ready for Christmas. And the way we had the tree set up that year, we actually had two couches that we pinned in the corner of a room. And so, you know, the couches are next to each other and then the walls. So there's this like little square in the corner of the room. And that's where we put the Christmas tree. And we put all the Christmas gifts there. And that was because Rafa was 1 year old and we didn't want anyone getting into the gifts. And so I walked over to the kitchen. I was talking with Christine about something. And then sure enough, I was gone probably no longer than 60 seconds. And I come back and this is what I find. I find Rafa somehow had gotten into the tree, grabbed a gift, and he grabbed one of his own gifts, which was pretty cool, and then he just started opening it. It's a bar of chocolate, and when that happens, you just, I don't know, you just say, that's really cute, you can have your bar of chocolate today, I guess. And so he stole his Christmas gift early, because that was before Christmas, and so affectionately, we call that year the year that Rafa stole Christmas, and and we let him have his chocolate bar, but you know, he also, now he's in at Harvard Christian Academy, and they had their little Christmas concert this week. And so here's Rafa. There's a poem that he got to learn with his class. And so now, in an effort to redeem his foolish ways at Christmas time, he's going to get to share this with you over video. All right, let's watch this.
Clock, 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 with the donkey's feet. Clock, 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 down the salty street. Knock, knock. God with Mary's head, but she was tired and needed a bed. Knock, knock, knock with Joseph at the door. Do you have room for just one more? No, 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 the innkeeper said. But you can use the stable for a bed. Shh, 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 what's that?
All right, pretty good, Rafa. You're doing pretty good these days. And it's that story that we are diving into here in Luke chapter 2. You know, I'm a pastor's kid too, and my dad used to use me in illustrations, and I hated it. So I figured I'd just start getting some in before he's too old and he can remember it. So that's why I went ahead and included him today. But so Luke chapter 2, we're going to start at verse 1. Excited to dive into God's word together, but let me pray before we get started. Father, we come to you today expectant to hear from you. God, we don't just want to hear someone talk for 40 minutes. We want to hear from you. We need to hear from you, for you are the head of this church, and you are the one who leads us. And so for this passage that maybe some of us we've read before, God, we're just asking that you would make it come to life today, that we would see things we haven't seen before, knowing that your word will never change, but Lord, our perspective changes. And so we want to see more in it today. I ask that you would bless this time, and it's in the name of Jesus we pray. All God's people said, amen. Amen. All right, here we go. Luke chapter 2. Let me give you just a little bit of context of what happens in the book. So there's an intro in chapter 1 where Luke addresses the book to Theophilus. And then we have John the Baptist, the story of John the Baptist. So Zechariah and Elizabeth, the angel comes and tells them and talks to them. And then the angel speaks to Mary. And then John the Baptist is born. And then Zechariah prophesies, and that's what happens in the first chapter. And then we get to chapter 2, which is where we're going to jump in. And verse 1 says this: in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is Bethlehem. So check this map out I have on screen right here, just to remind you of where Nazareth and Bethlehem are. So they're Nazareth up in Galilee, and they, you notice the scripture says they go up to Jerusalem. So even though in the map they're going down, Jerusalem and Bethlehem are in the mountains. And so if you're walking there, you're thinking, I'm going up to Bethlehem. I'm going up in that direction. And so that's where they go to, and the reason they go to there is because that's the lineage of Joseph. And so verse 5 says they're going there and to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger. Now, when we think of manger, normally you think of what I think of, which is those like two wooden planks and then like this beautiful hay in the middle and this nice little baby in there. Most likely that's not what a manger was in the time of Jesus. A manger more often than not was actually made of stone. So they would just find a big rock and then they would carve out the top just enough that you could put food in there for animals. And so it's a feeding trough is what it is. And so that's what they have baby Jesus. They wrap him in his cloth and then they put him in this feeding trough. And it finishes saying, because there was no place for them in the inn. Then verse 8 now introduces the next characters in this story. And in the same region, so in the region of Bethlehem, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. So shepherds are just, you know, blue-collar workers. They take care of sheep. And most of them actually lived outside of the town. So they, when they're in the field, most likely that's where they lived. So they lived in the field, they have a tent, and that's where they eat, that's where they sleep, and they're keeping watch over their flock by night, and we know it's many shepherds because they have to take turns watching the sheep every night. So at least one shepherd's awake at this time because they're watching over their flock by night. Maybe a couple of them are sleeping, we don't even know how many there were, but they're watching over their flock by night. And then this happens, verse 9, and an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with fear. Yeah, no joke. I mean, I'd be filled with fear if I was in their situation. An angel of the Lord shows up. So when we see that phrase, angel of the Lord, sometimes in the Old Testament, that can refer to the second person in the Trinity, to Jesus himself. Here, obviously, it's not that, being that Jesus just was born in Bethlehem. And I think in the context of the book, if you flip back to chapter 1, verse 11, you'll see the same phrase where there appeared to him an angel of the Lord. And that angel, if you jump over to verse 19, identifies himself as Gabriel. And the angel answered him, I am Gabriel. And then the angel that appears to Mary is also Gabriel in verse 26. And then in chapter 2, we're not told the name of the angel, but I feel like it's a pretty safe assumption to say by this point, it's probably Gabriel. I don't know if like the angels unionized between chapter 1 and 2, and if it's like someone else's turn now, they have new leadership. I don't know what's going on, but most likely I think it's Gabriel here in chapter 2. And so he shows up, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. So glory here represents this heavenly brightness that is coming out of the sky, and the phrase, and it's shining around them, should let you understand how much light we're talking about. So let me illustrate this for you in this way. All right, let's do this first. Let's go ahead and just turn off the house lights all the way. It's okay. Everybody's safe. There's exits in the back if you need to go. So here we are. Now we're in darkness, kind of like it's nighttime. Now go ahead and turn the stage lights up. All right, so now there's brightness here, but if you could see what I'm seeing from this perspective, about, you know, five rows in, the light is no longer shining around you. Okay, even though this is very bright, it's not enough to fill this room. And I think this room is about the size of a field, something I would consider a field. Now go ahead and turn the house lights up all the way. Okay, so it took that many lights for us to say that this brightness is bright enough to shine around you. So think about it. It's just one angel coming, and we don't know tons about angels, but one of the things we do know from God's word is that in Psalm 103, verse 20, it refers to them as mighty ones. So if an angel showed up, and you guys can put the lights back to normal wherever they were before I asked for that illustration, just a normal amount of glory is fine. So the angel of the Lord appears, and the glory of the Lord shines around them, and they're filled with fear because these angels are referred to as mighty ones, and I don't know exactly how that pans out, but I think when they show up, it's clear that they're strong in some way. I don't know if that means they're tall, they look buff, I don't know, but they're mighty ones, and then look at how much light comes out of heaven, and so they're filled with fear. And so that's why the angel has to start saying in verse 10, and the angel said to them, "Fear not." Now, I'm just going to go on record saying, if the angel told me, don't be afraid, I don't know if that would change much for me. But thankfully, for the shepherds, that was enough for them to be able to listen, because they're going to hear what the angel has to say, and they're going to act upon it. So we know they weren't too afraid that they couldn't listen anymore. I also think it's funny how there's one angel here showing up, right? Gabriel shows up, and then the rest of the angels are not going to come until verse 13. And it's probably because I can just imagine those angels being like, okay, we're going to send you, Gabriel, because if we all come, they're just going to pass out. Like, no one's going to listen to anything. So we got to send you, tell them not to be afraid, and then after you tell them what you need to tell them, then we'll all show up in verse 13, which we'll get to that in a second. All right, so then they're filled with fear. The angel tells them, "Fear not, for behold," and here it is, "I bring you good news of great joy." I bring you good news of great joy. Man, aren't you ready for some good news? Anybody ready for some good news? I am so ready for some good news. And not like when your friend comes up to you and he's like, "Hey, I got some good news and some bad news. Which one do you want first?" I can't stand that. You know what that is? It's just a trick to give you a lot of bad news in a way that makes you think something good happened. No, really, normally there's never really good news in that fashion. But what I'm sharing with you today is no joke. Really, really good news. Good news of great joy. I'm going to share with you four things that I see in this passage that I want to observe as we study. What is this good news? He's bringing them good news. Let's study. What is it? And we're going to observe four things. And the first one is that this good news is a message for all. It's a message for all. It's right there in that passage. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. That will be for all the people. It's a message for all. This good news is a message for all. That will be, the sentence is structured in a way that we're referencing the fact that it's good news for all people. And if you study what kind of good news it is, it's so good that it leads you to great joy. That's the kind of good news it is. But the news itself is for all people. Not just for those who will receive it and have great joy. It's for everyone. This is good news for you. And I can confidently say that because it's built into the passage that even though it's true that the angels are saying this to the shepherds, but as they're telling the shepherds, they're telling them that it's a message for all the people. So I can tell you today that this is good news for you, for every single one of you, everyone who can hear my voice. It's good news for you. So what is the good news? Well, it's in the next verse, an awesome verse. It says, verse 11, "For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is Christ the Lord." Let me just unpack that verse for you. There's a lot in there, all right? So let me unpack that for you. First, it says, and I love this part, it's the title of our series. He says, "For unto you." Don't jump over that. That is awesome. That is amazing that God is saying, "Unto you." And who's the you? It's all people. All the people. "Unto you." This is amazing to me. "Unto you and unto me." After mankind had sinned against God in the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3, and they have to leave Eden, and after God has to send a flood to basically start over with Noah and his family, and after God made a promise to Abraham, and after Joseph sees God use for good what man meant for evil, and after Israel is freed from the slavery in Egypt, after Moses receives the Ten Commandments, and Israel is making idols while he's away, after Israel has a king in Saul, and David, and Solomon, and then they have a civil war between the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, after Isaiah prophesies, and after the Babylonian captivity, after Daniel's prayers, and after Nebuchadnezzar's reign, after Nehemiah rebuilds Jerusalem, and Ezra stands up and reads the law of the Lord after decades of being in exile, and after 400 years of no prophet standing up and saying, "Thus says the Lord," 400 years of silence where they're not hearing from God, and then they're under the oppression of the Roman Empire, then an angel of the Lord comes to the shepherds and says, "Unto you." This is amazing. This is the story of how God works with us. We're not that great. You just need to know that. Every time we get a chance to do something right, mankind just says, we're going to throw that right back in God's face. And he is gracious towards us. And you need to understand that when we say that God is gracious, we are acknowledging that whatever benefit we're receiving from him, we have not earned and we cannot deserve. And it makes it all the more beautiful that it's his grace towards us. And it is God's grace today to you that he is saying, "Unto you." "Unto you is born this day in the city of David." And as soon as the angel said, "in the city of David," these shepherds, because they were Jewish, their ears would have perked up. They would have been like, "Wait, wait, wait. In the city of David, are you saying it's the one? Are you saying it's the Messiah?" Because that's a reference to the prophecy that the Messiah would come from the city of David. So the angel says, "Unto you is born this day in the city of David." Then he says this, "A Savior." A Savior. He is, this baby, is a Savior. A Savior from what? Well, let's look right back at chapter 1, verse 77, as Zechariah is prophesying. He says this sentence, "to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins." The reason we need a Savior is because we have a problem. And that problem is sin. Sin is when you miss the mark, when you don't do the things that God has said we need to do. God made us, and he said, "This is how I made you to be. This is what you're supposed to be." And we say, "No, God, we don't want to be that. We want to do things our way." And that's sin. We're going against the law of the Lord. And that's why we have this problem. We've been separated from God because of this sin, and that's why we need a Savior. We need someone to save us from our sin. And see, here's the thing. When God saves you, he saves you from these two things. He saves you first from who you had become. Because of your sin, you became a certain kind of person, and God saves you from who you had become. And imagine it as someone who's drowning, and they're drowning in their own sin. They're going to die in their own trespasses, and God shows up. He reaches down, and he pulls you out of that water, and he saves you. He's your Savior from what you had become. But don't miss what the other side of what God is doing when he saves you. He saves you from what you had become, but he also saves you from who you were gonna be. Not just who you had become in your sin, he saves you from who you were going to become. Had he not shown up, had he not saved you, you would have been this person continuing in your sin. And both those things, God is worthy to be praised for. And it's really, really important that you understand that if you were saved out of something that was very visible to the world, right? So I'm stuck in this addiction, then God saves me out of it. That is awesome, but you cannot let that make you think you're better or you're worse than anyone else who needs a Savior. And if you weren't saved out of something that felt super visible, quote unquote, in the eyes of man, but you were saved still from the sin that was in your heart and the way that was playing out, and no one really saw that right away, you still need to praise God, because you would have become all those things had God not saved you when he did. He saves you from who you had become, and he saves you for who you were going to become. And God deserves praise for all those things. And no one is any better or worse than anyone else based off when God saved them. And that's why you have to come to God and say, I need a Savior. You need a Savior. No one is closer to God than another person. There's no such thing as almost saved. At the end of the day, all there is he either is your Savior or he's not. And if he is your Savior, he deserves praise for what he pulled you out of, and he deserves praise for what you don't have to be anymore. See, Jesus Christ is your Savior, and he has conquered death, and he has conquered the power of sin. You don't have to become who you were going to become, because if you found Jesus, you found what the angel proclaimed that day, that he is a Savior. He's a Savior, but not just that, he is a Savior who is Christ. Christ. So this word showing up is a direct reference to the fact that he is the one that was promised to Israel. See, Israel is waiting for its deliverer, and when the angel says a Savior who is Christ, he's telling them the Messiah has come. It's him. It's the one you've been waiting for. It's him who is Christ, and then last two words, the Lord. The Lord refers to the fact that he has power. The Lord refers to the fact that he has all authority. The Lord refers to the fact that he has the right to rule. And if you need a Savior, man, see, this is why it's such a beautiful phrase that he is a Savior who is Christ the Lord, because if you need someone to rip you out of from where you are, you need him to have power. You need him to have the ability to save you, and that is exactly who this baby is. He's the Savior who is Christ the Lord. And so if that's what the good news is, it just makes me wonder, since we know that it's a message for all, have we treated this message as if it's a message for us? Or is it a message for all? You know, I've been so blessed as we've been going through the book of Mark. One of the things that stood out to me is just how Pastor Dave's been talking about how our job is to just scatter the seed and let the Lord do the work. And that is the work of the Christmas message. Luke chapter 2, he's telling us this good news is for all people. That doesn't mean everyone's going to receive it and accept it, but it's for all people. And I'm thankful for that. So then what happens? All right, verse 12, the angel says, And this will be a sign for you that you will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger. So swaddling cloths, why swaddling cloths? In the Jewish culture, when a baby was born, they believed that what you needed to do was stretch out their limbs, that you would stretch out their arms and their legs as soon as they were born, and so that's why they would wrap them in these cloths. And the fact that the baby is wrapped in cloths is a direct reference to the fact that this baby is newly born. So you will find this newborn baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in this feeding trough. And so the sign will be for you that you'll see both those things. So you're going to go to Bethlehem, shepherds, and you're going to find a newborn baby lying in a feeding trough, and that's going to be the sign that that baby is the Savior who is Christ the Lord. Now, I think it's really interesting to notice that this sign that the angel proclaims to the shepherds has already occurred by this point. Jesus is born in verse 6, and here we are sometime later, we don't know how long, but after the fact, and they're being proclaimed that there is a sign. And that is exactly how it's happening today still. That the sign of Jesus coming has already occurred. He came, he showed up on earth, and now our job is to do what the angels are doing and proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, though the sign has already happened. And just like the shepherd, now they have to go to Bethlehem and find this sign. So verse 12, we see that their sign is proclaimed, and we see that our sign is recorded in God's word for us to believe. So it's a message for all, and then this, it's a peace to receive. It's not just a message for all, but it's also a peace to receive. Verse 13 says, and suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, okay, interesting that the angels, the army of angels show up suddenly. I don't know if I would have done it that way. I kind of be like, okay, there come the angels little by little. But no, here what actually happens is after the angel of the Lord says what he just said, then boom, there's an army of angels. How much brighter did it get? I don't know. But it gets really, really intense, and they're praising God, and they're saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. All right, so I'm going to need your help in the sermon today. I need your help being the army. All right, I know if you don't like raising your voice, just give me a pass here today. I want to hear what this army of angels kind of would have sounded like. So if you have verse 14, you can look it in your Bibles or have it on the screen too. All right, I want every voice helping me out. So the army of angels show up and they say, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased. That's what the angels are saying. And if you've read this verse in different translations, it varies a little bit, because the idea here is they're saying there is glory to God in the highest places, referring to heaven. God is praised in the highest places, but on earth there will be peace among mankind because of the goodwill of God. This peace that we're talking about originates and flows from God himself. And this is a broader sense of the word peace, more than just the cessation of strife or conflict, as we think of the word peace, which it is. This is a broader sense. It's the full sum of the blessings associated with the coming of the Messiah. The full sum of the blessings associated with the coming of the Messiah, which makes me wonder, am I receiving that peace? The full sum of the blessings associated with the coming of the Messiah, or am I striving to fix everything myself? See, if you're anything like me, when I got saved, it's like I acknowledged him as Savior, and then somehow the years following, by my actions, I was showing the Lord that I was trying to take his job from him as my Savior. I was working, I was striving. And when I use the word striving, that refers to actions outside of Jesus. It's not like I'm the vine, you are the branches. It's like saying, I don't need a vine. I can just do this on my own. That's striving. And what God is saying is, no, I'm the vine, you're the branches. I am the Savior, and I want you to have the full sum of the blessings associated with me being your deliverer. That is what God offers you, a peace to receive this Christmas. It's a message for everyone, and it's a peace to receive that Jesus is our deliverer. So we continue in verse 15. We see what the shepherds are going to do after the angels proclaim this. Now, if you've ever asked yourself the question, why shepherds? Like, I've heard people say, like, why couldn't it be the blacksmiths, you know, of Bethlehem? Like, we don't really know why God chose the shepherds. I don't even think that's that significant of a question. I think a more important question to ask is, why were the shepherds a good choice? What do we see in what they did that shows us that they were a good choice by the Lord to proclaim this message to them? Well, I see two things in the passage. The first one, I think more importantly than anything, let's just see what they did. Well, verse 15, when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. This is amazing, their response, because I see, and I think this is why they were a good choice to be told this message, is because they believed God and they did what he said they should do. They believed him, and they did what he said they should do. You know, I talk to people every so often, and they ask me the question, you know, I want to be used by God, but I just don't know what I'm supposed to do. And if you want to be a candidate to be used by God for his kingdom and for his purposes, start here. believe him for what he says and do what he says you should do. And you're going to get blown away what God can do with someone who believes him and does what he says they should do. I love how the shepherds say, let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened. Not to see if this thing has happened. They believe the angel of the Lord. They believe him because they say it has happened. And then I love that they say, which the Lord has made known to us. Not the angel of the Lord, but they believe that it comes straight from God, an expression of faith that we see of the shepherds, that they're saying this message is from God himself. They're believing him, and then they're going to do what he said they should do. So they're believing him, they're doing what he said he should do, and then secondly, we see that they're going to bear witness of what God did, and that's the second reason why I think the Lord chose them. Verse 16 says, and they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph, so they run over to Bethlehem, they find the baby that's in the feeding trough, and the baby lying in a manger. Verse 17, and when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. So they bear witness of what they had observed. This is really important. Just flip back to Luke chapter 1, and we see why Luke is writing this book. The very first few verses, Luke chapter 1, verse 2 says this, just as though those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught. See, in a Jewish court, if you wanted to verify something is true, you needed to have two or three witnesses that were eyewitnesses say this was true. And the awesome thing about that is these shepherds become the eyewitnesses, and then Luke writes it down. Why? So that you and I can have certainty that this happened. And they are bearing witness of what God did there. And then, so it's a message for all, it's a peace to receive, and then this, starting in verse 17, when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning the child, and all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. All who heard it, so now there's people for sure around. I don't know if they're like directly with Joseph and Mary or near them, but we know they're somewhere in the area because these are the people that the shepherds are talking to, and when they hear the news, they wondered is the word that we have in Scripture. It's like marveled. They were fascinated or intrigued by it, which is very interesting. They're not saying that they received it and they believed it and then they praised God. None of that happens. They wonder at it. They're just like, oh, that's really interesting. So an angel spoke to you and the baby's here. That's really, really interesting to us. And I think that's important because of the next word in verse 19 that says, but Mary. Anytime you come across the word but in Scripture, you need to ask yourself, why is this a contrasting word instead of something to connect it with the previous thing? It's saying differently than what we just read. And so different to the people who saw all that had happened and they wondered, they were just kind of like fascinated by it. We have this response from Mary. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. But Mary treasured up all these things. See, this is the third thing I observe in this passage. It's a message for all, a peace to receive, but it's also a choice to treasure. It's a choice to treasure what's going on at Christmas. And Mary made that choice to treasure. It says that she treasured all these things. To treasure means that she guarded this event closely. That's what it means. She guarded the event closely. She drew near to it instead of just being like, oh, that's interesting, right? Like there's a distance in wondering. There's a nearness in treasuring. So that's what she's doing. She's guarding it closely. And pondering means that she threw all the things that had happened together in her mind and comparing them and letting one explain or add to the other. I can relate to that concept of pondering. Even when we had our kids, I remember both with Daniela and Raphael, the day of the delivery, whenever we were going to bed after the baby had been born, I remember just lying down in that couch in the hospital room and Christina in the bed next to me, And I remember pondering where I'm replaying the day because so much happened so fast. You're just like, what's going on? And then I'm lying there in bed and I'm just replaying the day and I'm pondering and I'm like, oh, I remember that. Yeah, it's almost like I didn't live that. And I have to tell myself, actually, you did live that, Eddie. And that is what happened. I'm pondering. I'm putting all these things in my mind because I want to treasure it. I want to treasure that memory. Which just begs the question, are we letting Christmas just fly by again this year? Are we just in the logistics of it? Okay, we got to see these family members. We got to buy these gifts. We got to do this. Okay, and then Christmas will be gone before you know it. Or are we choosing to treasure it closely like Mary did? So I want to share with you 5 ways to treasure Christmas. And these are very practical. And honestly, there's nothing special about this list. If you could come up with a way to treasure Christmas, you should do that one. Because by the very fact that you're choosing to do something, you're already treasuring it. Just by saying, I'm going to do this to treasure Christmas, whatever that is for you, you've done it because you're choosing to draw near rather than to distance yourself and just be, you know, in wonder and awe of what it is. You want to treasure it. You want to get close to it. So here are 5 ways you could do that. First, maybe you read Luke 2 every day, 5 days in a row. You read Luke chapter 2 every day, 5 days in a row. Another way you could do that is, secondly, you could skip a lunch break and pray and thank God for Christmas. I think the key in this one is I find it very useful to break my routine. And when I do something that's outside of my normal routine, it actually engages my heart more. And so what I'm saying is skip a lunch, so something where it would just be like typical work day for you, and you do something completely different. You say, I'm going to dedicate that lunch hour, and I'm going to pray, and I'm going to thank God for Christmas, and I'm going to focus on the Christmas story and pray. Third, maybe you could journal scriptures that apply to each line of a Christmas carol. You could pull out your journal, pick a Christmas carol, a real Christmas carol, not like Jingle Bell Rock or anything. I mean, like something that actually talks about Christmas. Pick a carol and then just start writing down scriptures next to each line. And what that's going to do is it's just going to slow you down. Treasuring something slows you down. And I think that's a good thing for us, that we're going to get close to it. We're going to slow down. Fourth, you could go on a walk and pray through the blessings you received in Jesus. Again, this has to do with breaking that routine. And it's, I mean, it's getting a little cold now, but you could probably do a short walk outside and go for a prayer walk and focus on specifically what are the blessings you received in Jesus and just pray those things to him and thank God for that. And in so doing, you will be treasuring Christmas. And fifth, maybe as you gather with your friends or your family before any traditions, prioritize the fact that you want to speak God's word over them. So you're going to speak Luke chapter 2, read the passage over your friends and family, and in so doing, you're saying, we want to get close to this. Not speed, not convenience, no. We're going to prioritize it. We're going to make sure we're treasuring up Christmas. 5 ways to treasure Christmas. And like I said, if you can come up with a completely different one, I think that's awesome, and I think you should do that one. But I just wanted to help you. I wanted to be helpful today. If you want to pick one of these, this would be a way you can get near the Christmas story and treasure it just like Mary did and pondered these things in her heart. So it's a message for all. It's a peace to receive. It's a choice to treasure. And then finally this, it's a reason to praise. Verse 20 says, "And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen as it had been told to them." Who are they praising? What's his name? Well, verse 21 says, "At the end of 8 days, when he was circumcised, he was called Jesus, the name given by the angel before he was conceived in the womb." That's who they're praising, Jesus. It stood out to me. I don't think I'd ever noticed that the angel does not announce the name Jesus here in Luke chapter 2. He announces that this is a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And then after 8 days, after he's circumcised, then they give him the name that was prophesied, that he is Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. See, the shepherds found a reason to praise. Christmas is supposed to lead you to praise, just like the shepherds did. And I know that might be hard for some of you, because Christmas might not be your favorite time of the year. It might be other people's favorite time of year, but not for you, because Christmas reminds you of something very difficult. And maybe it's you lost someone around Christmas time. And every time all these traditions start, you start seeing the lights, it just starts bringing up everything you felt when you lost that someone. And you could have maybe not even lost them at Christmas time. You could have just lost them earlier that year. And then when you got to Christmas, it forced your heart to actually start processing through things that were very painful. And Christmas brings that back. Or maybe as you see all these traditions and you see families and friends getting together, it's just such a blaring picture and a reminder that your family is broken. And it's not what you would want it to be. And Christmas reminds you of that. Or maybe Christmas reminds you just that you're broken. Well, if that's you, I just want you to know that Christmas is meant to lead you to praise. And so what you need to do is you have to preach to yourself what I've preached to you today. You have to preach to yourself, do I have a Savior? Has He pulled me out of where I was? And has He saved me from what I was going to become? And do I have a Christ who is the Messiah? Do I have someone who's delivered me? Do I have someone who fulfilled all His promises to me? And do I have a Lord who stands with power and authority and the right to rule? And if the answer is yes to that, what your heart should want to do is praise God for it. And all you have to do is say yes to God. You just have to say, look, I don't get everything that you're doing, but I know since you are Lord and you have power and authority, the fact that I'm walking through what I'm walking through, God, I'm going to choose to believe you, and I'm going to do what I know to do that you have said, and I'm going to trust that there's a reason for why I'm walking through this, that there's an awesome reason, and you might not get to know that today or tomorrow. But you need to know that God is working all these things together for your good, because that is the good news of Christmas. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray for us, and then we're going to praise the Lord. And no matter what you're walking through, I just want to invite you to think upon the things that we've talked about today and let that fuel your praise. All right? Let's stand together and let's pray. Father, we're thankful that we have a Savior in this baby, Jesus, that He is Christ the Lord, and He is the one that we've gathered here today to praise. And we take this time every year, God, and we want to focus specifically on the first coming of your Son. And we want to treasure these things, and we want to ponder these things. Lord, for all of us who just feel like we're flying by Christmas, that we're rushing through it, would you just help us to slow down? And Lord, Holy Spirit, where there is someone in this room right now who needs comfort, I just pray that you would do that like only you can do, that you would comfort the heart that's hurting. And thank you that you say that you are near to the brokenhearted. And let it be that we don't just receive comfort, but that it would drive us to praise you. For you are worthy of that praise this Christmas, Lord. You are the reason to praise. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Amen. Amen.